In this episode, we'll weld aluminum with a TIG welder. Hi folks, I'm Custom Cez and I welcome you to this new episode of Roma Custom Bike, where we'll try to bring some clarity on an interesting yet still for some mysterious subject. How does a TIG welder work? So let's get right to it and let's try to understand what are we dealing with. TIG, tungsten inert gas, where the tungsten is the material of which the electrode is made of and the inert gas is the gas coming out of the torch's nozzle. Commonly argon gas. The lens, the pink piece at the end of the gun that adds a much needed feminine touch to an overly masculine design, can have different shapes and it affects the way the gas is dispensed onto the weld and the amount needed to shield it properly. Here's how it works. The electrode is charged with enough voltage to create an arc with the part and enough amperage to create the heat necessary to melt the parts that need to be welded together. Once you have created a little pool of melted metal, we can start adding the metal filler to fill up the space between the two parts and strengthen the joint. You do need to get into the right rhythm though. You add the filler and then you spread it with a torch. If you get it right, you'll get the sought-after stacked coin look, typical of this welding technique. To join two thicker pieces, it's ideal to bevel the edges to form a V-shaped gap between the two pieces and ensure a deep penetration of the weld. If needed, more passages can be overlapped to achieve full filling of the gap. But why the gas, you may ask? Well, the inert gas is there to protect the melted metal from contamination from the oxygen that would cause oxidation and result into a weak weld. Okay, now that we know the what, we can get into the how. You know that I suck as a welder and I usually let my partner Polsky Rage take care of the welding for me. But although he's an expert at MIG welding, TIG is a new thing for him too, so I figured I needed to ask for help and find someone with the right experience to show me how it's done. For that, I resorted to the official Facebook page of the show and I posted an help request. By the way, the link to our Facebook page is in the description. Anyway, my call for help was immediately answered by Paolo Di Russo, another customizer from Rome that promptly offered his help.
Ciao, io sono Paolo, appassionato meccanica, motociclismo e gli serviva una persona per poter effettuare queste saldature a TIG in alluminio e niente, mi sono proposto di dargli una mano così, anche per conoscerlo personalmente.
Paolo is the best guy ever. He showed up with his own equipment, fillers, even his own argon tank. Polsky and I some time ago bought a TIG welder too. But I guess it's not the right kind for aluminum welding.
Cesare ha acquistato una saldatrice a TIG in corrente continua, però non è possibile utilizzarla per saldare l'alluminio perché richiede appunto una saldatrice AC per permettere alla saldatrice di spaccare l'ossido dell'alluminio.
That's right, Paolo. So, let's clear that up. When exposed to oxygen, aluminum forms an oxide layer that melts at a much higher temperature than the aluminum itself, 3600 degrees Fahrenheit versus the 1200 degrees Fahrenheit of the base material. To solve this problem, AC welding has two cycles. During the first cycle, called EP or electropositive, where the current flows from the workpiece to the electrode, the aluminum oxide is blasted off the surface, creating a clean area. During the second cycle, called EN or electronegative, where the current flows from the electrode to the work, the arch produces enough heat to melt the clean aluminum and fuse the joint. The two cycles combine the cleaning stage to the welding one. Now that we know how the material reacts to the process, we can start setting the machine. The base setting we used were based on Paolo's past experience, but then we adjusted them to better suit our project. We set the power to 140 amperes, given the thickness of our aluminum being 5 mm. And then we set the pulser. The pulser allows for the operator to keep temperatures of the workpiece in check, alternating between two amperage values, the maximum and the minimum. He can decide the frequency of the switches and the percentage of the time of one phase over the other. All of this is to try to keep the workpiece at an ideal temperature. Then we have the pulse flow setting. It determines how many seconds the flow of gas will remain active after the arch is shut off. This is done so that the weld can be protected from oxygen contamination long enough for it to cool off. Now that we know what the controls do, it will be easier for us to adjust the settings as we start encountering problems along the way. Before we continue though, I would like to remind you that we are an independent production and we need support to keep bringing you quality content like we have for the past 3 years. If you haven't already subscribed to the channel, please do so. Like and share our videos on your social media. And if you would like, please visit our official site www.romacustombike.com, where you can find our custom handmade in Italy accessories and our t-shirt from the show, the best way to share our name in the real world. Thank you very much for the support that you have already shown, and let's keep going with the TIG welding. To achieve great results, another important step is the cleaning and preparation of the piece prior to welding. For this demonstration, I've prepared two pieces of 5 mm scrap aluminum left over from another project. We start with some sanding to remove the impurities we find on the surface. And then we follow what we have talked about at the beginning of the video, beveling the edges to create a V-shaped gap between the pieces to ensure a nice and deep weld. Excellent, just the way I like them. This makes for a nice and low weld, saving us some time also in the finishing process. Now we use the bench grinder to shape the tip of the electrode, a nice and round tip like suggested by the welder manual. Once ready, it's inserted in the torch in a way that sticks out about 10 millimeters from the top. Paolo can now wear his helmet, also a Miller of course, and we're ready to go. Tension in the air is now palpable. He gets in position. Let's do this thing. In this first weld, you could really see the pulser function in action, raising and lowering the amperage at set times and values to keep temperatures at bay. The result is real nice. You can see the area surrounding the weld that got cleaned during the EP electron positive cycle. Let's take a look from another angle. We can see that Paolo stays on the starting spot until he gets the material hot enough to create the paddle. Then he begins to add the filler rod. Here, you just witnessed the pulse flow of gas, about 4 seconds after the arch is shut down, just like we said before. I shot this through an electronic welding mask, so that we can actually see a little bit better what goes on during welding. This is pretty hypnotic stuff. If you ask me, it's a little bit like watching the fire burn. As you can see, the process has its own rhythm. Melt, add, spread, melt, add, spread, and so on and so forth. And that's why many people like to listen to music while they do the welding, so that they can keep a good steady rhythm and produce a nice and evenly spaced weld. So, now it's my turn. Let's put this to the test right away.
Hai visto? Sto cercando di prendere un ritmo.
Sì.
All right, not that bad for a first timer. As you know, I think that everyone should specialize on something, but also be able to do a little bit of everything. And I think I got the gist of it now.
Non firma? No, vai,
sì. Sì, sì.
Figo. Bello questo, eh.
Another feature of this welding machine is the pedal that allows to control the power just like a human pulsar function. This way Paolo really has maximum control over the melted metal pool. If he needs more, he presses more. If he needs less, he holds back the foot.
Ok, quindi abbiamo, diciamo, impostato un massimo di 140 ampere e con questo noi andiamo a regolare, cioè ossia se spingiamo a fondo siamo sui 240 ampere, riducendo e riduciamo la potenza della calcolatura.
Here is one more shot where we can see the pushing motion that he's doing with the torch. The more steady the move, the easier it is to get the iconic stacked coin effect. Now that we have practiced a bit and refined the settings for the type and thickness of the material, we're ready to weld the piece that started this whole thing. My awesome aluminum mini chain cover. The piece has been machined and then bent. So now the corners need to be welded and reinforced before we can proceed with powder coating. Again, we clean the parts with a sanding block. It is important to find a comfortable position that will allow for the full movement required by the weld. Here Paolo touched the electrode to the piece and it got welded on it. We will remove it later with a grinder. A good old cinematic cooling of the piece in a bucket of water and the part is ready for some powder coating. Process that I did the next day. Here it is now, all done and installed on the bike with all the copper inserts typical of my designs. So, now I can say that to work on heavy structural things, I still prefer the stick welder. He makes for rugged welds on thick plates. To weld thin sheet metal like the stuff we've seen in the Speed Triple project, the MIG welder is still my preferred choice. Last but not least, if you have the skills like Paolo for welding aluminum or very controlled welds, TIG is the way to go. Cool guys, if you have made it up to here, it means you like the episode, so please remember to click the like button, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and share our videos on your social networks, because that helps us tremendously spreading the word. Visit www.romacustombike.com, the official show site, and check out the new custom handmade accessories that we have been producing and our show t-shirt. I am Custom Cez, and this is it for this episode. I'll see you in the next episode of Roma Custom Bike.